morning, everyone. It's so wonderful to see your beautiful faces. And as you see, I will be doing your announcements this morning. Okay, first in the announcements, we want to remind everybody to not forget to let us know that you're here by checking in at www.fumctupelo.com/I'm here. So whether that be online or here, just let us know that you are here. And we have the women's Bible study that is going on Wednesdays from 6 to 7 p.m. in the gathering room. So if anyone wants to be a part of that, just feel free to join us. We have still a need for greeters. So if you want to help on Sunday mornings, we still have a need for that. And if you want to join us in that, visit signup.com, go, and whatever that is, I can't see it, to sign up. But it will be, just go sign up there if you like to be a greeter. We are still in need of that. And let us remember that we're going to be celebrating Reverend Mary Strickland, pastor of Youth and College Ministries, May the 20th in the gathering room after church. The last day to collect offering for her will be May 17th. So let's be reminded of that. The scripture we'll be reading from today will be Psalm 92, 1 and 4, 1 through 4, and 92, 12 through 15. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High, proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night to the music of the 10-string lyre and the melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds. Lord, I sing for joy at what your hands have done. The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will still stay fresh and green, proclaiming, the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today before we ask for anything. We just want to say thank you for all your many wonderful blessings. We thank you for your grace and your mercy and your unmerited favor and everything that you've done for us. Now we ask that you dwell with us here and anoint us all for your service as we are here to give you praise. And it'll be all for your glory, God. And we thank you and we ask you all these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand and worship.
This kind of love you've shown. Pray together. Oh God, how true it is that you hold us up when we feel like we have fallen short. You are the one who finishes for us. When we feel like we don't belong, it's only because we've forgotten our identity in you. Oh God, your children, your very sons and daughters. We don't just belong, but we belong to the family of the King. How grateful we are. God, we ask that you would continue now that good work that you have already begun in each of us, that you would accomplish your purposes in us this day. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture this morning is taken from, excuse me just a second, I'm going to grab myself a little platform. I knew I was forgetting something earlier this morning. But it is from 1 Samuel. We are continuing our Stories from Samuel series, and this morning We are looking at 1 Samuel chapter 15, verses 34 chapter 16, verses, looks like 13. I don't know. I can hardly read this. So here we go. Then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house in Gibeah of Saul. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death. And Samuel grieved over Saul. And the Lord was sorry that he had made Saul king over Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shema pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all of your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy, and he had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me now, if you will. And now, God, I ask that either through me or in spite of me, that you will speak to these, your people. Amen. It's interesting that we don't really get a whole lot about Saul. I mean, Saul is anointed to be the king, and even though Samuel didn't want to anoint him as king and warned the people about what would happen if he was anointed as king, yet he was. But in the lectionary passages, which is what we're following for this series, we're using the text from the lectionary, it skips over Saul. I mean, you could say that Saul's basically just passed over. He's there, but he's not really there. And it's kind of interesting because you have a whole lot about Saul. You have a whole lot about what he looked like, and you have a lot about his battles, and you also have a lot about his failures. But this is one of the things I want you to know about Saul. Saul was tall. Saul was tall. I mean, it's one of the first things that's said about Saul is that he stood head and shoulders above everybody else. Now, this past week, my son Isaac was at Boy Scout camp, and one of the things that they did throughout the week was they sent pictures of the boys. And I don't know if it's because he was standing on a stump, I don't know, but my son Isaac was like a, he was like a head taller than any of the other boys. Now, I went to camp and I saw some of the other boys, and some of the other boys were just as tall as he is. But when this particular picture, it just looked like he's just this, you know, 6'5" giant amongst 5'5" people. It was an interesting thing. But that was one of the things about Saul, is that he was tall. And it's an interesting sociological thing that there is some truth to the fact that tall people seem to get ahead in life. That's not intended pun, Tom, but I mean, it could be if you thought about it long enough. It seems to be that sometimes in some ways that it's the tall person. And now, a lot has been made about Imbra's height, and he talked about how that when he would, even though he wasn't that great at basketball, he would get chosen just because he was tall. We all forget that Fred Britton was actually a good bit taller than any of us, but that's okay. I mean, he was only 6'6", so no big deal. But this whole thing of being tall, you get picked for certain things. I mean, indeed, if you look at the sports heroes that we have, though there are some that are not tall, by and large, the ones we remember are the Shaquille O'Neals. There's a lot made of professional football players being tall, particularly quarterbacks being tall so they can see over everyone. But then you have some of these that, well, they're not tall. There are times when it's not the tall ones. Now, I grew up, I wasn't really into stick and ball sports. I was into motorsports. And I was the opposite of what I needed to be to succeed in motorsports, because I was tall. And if you know anything about jockeys of horses or drivers or race cars, most of the successful ones are short. Some of them are ridiculously short. And if you are a MotoGP motorcycle racer, then you're not just short, you are tiny. You're just a small frame person. And those are the ones that succeed there. But in the view of Saul being chosen as this great king, even though it wasn't a good idea, what he was chosen as was he was taller than everybody else. He was also a man of war. We'll talk more about that later on in the series as we look at the end of Saul's life, but he was a man of war. And in fact, there is a particular passage where that he is being looked for and where he was hiding. It's not real clear in a lot of our English translations, but where he was hiding out, trying not to be found, was actually in the armory. He was where the weapons were kept. And that was the kind of person he was. But he was also fixed. He was fixed in his mind of what he needed to do and the way that he needed to go about doing things. And he was kind of one of these that we might describe as a self-made man in some ways, in other ways not, but he came to a place where he felt like he knew better than even God. And that's how we get to the story today. When he got to that place where he determinedly decided that he knew better than even God, there came a point in time where God said, well, we're going to move on. And we come to David. Now, I had really hoped to have a bunch of children up here today, and they would do this really fun skit. At least I thought it was fun because I wrote it. Where they would come up and do this thing and be the kids, and I was going to have my youngest be little Davy, which just made sense. Levi, come here real quick. Come here. It's okay. Come here. There we go. Yes. So he was going to be the one who was chosen. He was going to be the one who would be the last. He would be little Davy. But that didn't work out so well. Carla, you wore all the kids out. They're at the beach. But that's okay. But when it came to choosing one who was going to replace Saul, what Samuel immediately went for was, again, to the tall. He went to the one, this rugged young man who's big stature, yes, that's the one we're looking for. But it didn't go there. God, every time, said this, nope. What about this? Nope. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times God says no. And poor Samuel's looking around going, well, I don't know what to do here. I came to anoint a king. But none of the ones, God, you said the sons of Jesse. What's your middle name?
Jesse.
Yeah, okay, his middle name's Jesse. I could have had you be Jesse. It would have made more sense. But the sons of Jesse are actually not all there. There is another one. Little Davy, he's out tending the sheep. He is so insignificant in this story up to this point that even his own father didn't think it worthwhile to call him to this particular sacrifice and celebration. Okay, Levi, you can go sit down. Thank you. There are places and there are times when we get passed over. Now, you might be one of those who are always chosen. You might be one of those who were the first to be chosen in those lines of trying to pick out a player on the ball field. You might have been one of those who was first to be chosen to read lines in a play or to be the star in a particular show. You might be one of those who it was, you know, life has been relatively easy for you. I actually don't know many people like that. Even those who on the outside it appears that everything's good and hunky-dory. Most of us recognize and realize that life is hard and that there are challenges. But we are people who place a lot of importance on the outside, on how we look. One of the things that I love about a quote-unquote contemporary service, I just say quote-unquote because I'm not even sure what that means anymore because it looks like so many different things to so many different people. But one of the things that I really appreciate about it is that I don't have to wear a tie. In fact, forgive me, I would be in blue jeans today except for the fact that I've got to go over and be in the 11 o'clock traditional service, and even though I'm wearing a robe, I'm a little self-conscious about the fact that I would have a little bit of Levi's showing underneath my robe. I might prefer to be in Mizuno's this morning instead of wingtips. Well, these are actually cap toes. Those aren't wingtips. But anyhow, I might prefer to be a little bit more relaxed. In fact, there are probably some ways in which I'd like to be even more relaxed than that. Maybe more relaxed than you're comfortable with. Chacos might be my preferred shoe, particularly during the summer. But that is maybe not what you would prefer. I don't know. Here, I think it'd be okay. But even in a more relaxed state, we still pay a lot of attention to how we look. We're still concerned about our appearance and how we appear to others. It's not just, though, our appearance that we're concerned about. It's the appearance of what people think about our families and our relationships. It's our appearance about what others think about our vocations, our jobs, and the things that we do for fun and enjoy. We're concerned about what other people think of us, and sometimes, well, let's just be honest, sometimes we put up a false front. Let's be honest, sometimes we lie. And I don't mean that we're saying one thing to this person and yet we're actually doing something else. In the sense of lying, in the sense of telling an untruth, it's presenting an untruth. Sometimes we will present ourselves or our situation or our life in a particular way, and it's not true. So there is more than just our outward appearance. There's more than just our physical characteristics that we look at, our circumstances and our situations. And sometimes it's those circumstances and situations that we look at and we think that we would be passed over. When it comes time for someone, for God to use, that we would not be one of those people because of our circumstances and our situations. But here in the first book of Samuel, we have something else. We have something very different. God, it said, looks on the heart, looks on the inside, not on the outward appearance. Now, this is not the first time that we've seen this. In fact, we've already seen this a good bit. If you've listened to any of my sermons and actually paid attention a little bit, if you have, God bless you. But you will know that one of my favorite stories in the Bible is that of the Exodus, that of Moses. And one of the things that I love about this is that Moses is both the most unlikely character to be chosen. And the most. He's the most unlikely because, I don't know, let's go down the list here. Number one, he's killed someone before. He was a murderer. Go back and read, if you don't believe me, go back and read your Bible. It's in there, all right? Number two, at least in his eyes, he wasn't good at speaking. Some people would say he was a stammerer or has some other, some sort of speech difficulty. I'm not, you know, I don't know exactly what it was, but at least according to himself, he was a poor speaker. His job is to go and speak. This is where I like to just remind people that I thought that it was very unlikely that I would ever be up here looking at you and speaking because in college I failed speech. Twice. Third time I made an A. I learned my lesson. But it's this, these outward things, it looks like Moses shouldn't be the guy. Now just real quick, let me tell you the positives, why he absolutely should have been the guy. Well, I don't know. He grew up in Pharaoh's court. He knew the ins and out. Ever wondered how Moses just was told never to show up again, and then he just shows up again? Do you think the guards weren't looking for him? No, he played hide and seek there. He knew how to get around that place. That's how he knew. He knew the ins and the outs. If there was anybody that could do what Moses did, it was Moses. But from the outside, it appeared that there's no way he would be one who would be completely passed over. He would not be chosen. David, he was the youngest. Now, I had Levi up here, who's my youngest, and hi, I'm glad you came up here and joined me. That was fun, for me, anyhow. Was it okay for you? Okay, good. He likes a spotlight every now and then. That's good. But if you noticed, okay, David, first of all, he wasn't the firstborn. If we think about biblical numerology, he wasn't the thirdborn either. Neither was he the seventh. Do you know what the biblical significance of number eight is? Tom, what's the biblical significance of number eight? Yeah, there is no biblical significance to number eight. He's completely insignificant. He's insignificant to his own father. When I wrote this little skit thing, I had the kids say, But he's out with the sheep. He's going to stink. That's the significance, is that he stunk. he wasn't the chosen one at all. Now, it's funny that we have this big thing about we're not looking at the outward appearance. And what do we read there? Well, he was handsome and ruddy and beautiful eyes. Well, good for him. That's great. But God looks on the heart. The problem with Saul, remember this, he was fixed. His heart and his mind were fixed. But with David, we see some pliability. I've been reading this book lately. Actually, reading is not the correct word. I've been listening to this book by Dr. Sanjay Gupta, Build a Better Brain or something like that. And he talks about, and of course, brain scientists talk about this, neuroplasticity. That's a hard word to say. Neuroplasticity, which means that your brain can change, that your experiences in life can create changes in your brain. Mary Strickland and I had this conversation this morning because she was talking about having to drive the church bus, and it's kind of funny now that she legally can, she's not sure that she wants to. I don't blame her, but she's you know, she has this, and we had this discussion about the brain not, you know, being fully developed until you're like 25, and then she was corrected because she said that in front of someone who says, no, you're a female. It's 22 for you. It's like, golly, the guys got left out on that one. But for insurance purposes, it's still 25. But the great thing is, because of neuroplasticity, because our brains don't stop developing and stop, you can still learn and grow, and you can continue to, it might be harder to learn a new language at 50 than it was at, I don't know, 2, but you can still do it. It might be harder to figure out a new hobby when you're 35 than when you were 15, but you can still do it. There are things that you can still learn, and in fact, that's one of the keys they talk about, is continuing to learn. So never stop. But it's not just neuroplasticity that we need here. What we need here is cardioplasticity. We need our hearts to be able to continually be changed and transformed. We need to be in such a place that we, when we are faced with a corrective, can be corrected. But it's not just corrected from others, it's being corrected by God, being transformed by God. It's recognizing where it is that our hope, that our strength comes from. It's said of David that he was a man after God's own heart. But we look at his life, some of the things that he did in his life, and we go, man, I'm not so sure about that. It's one thing to look at David and Goliath and go, yeah, man after God's own heart, sees the giant, faces the giant, grabs up some stones, goes and defeats the giant. Woo! It's another thing when you go, but what about Bathsheba and Uriah? We're going to get there too. That's when we look at it and we might be taking a step back and going, well, what about this? It's something that we would look at like we looked at Moses and we go, well, that excludes. That means he can't be it. Jesus, when he was going about and he was choosing his disciples, he chose a bunch of people that would have been passed over. I mean, think about it. One, you have the fishermen. Fishermen, like shepherds, in their work, they might have stunk a bit. Just being kind of crass, maybe. But they were also pretty lowly in the social echelon. He chose tax collectors. I mean, a tax collector was a Roman colluder. Tax collectors were the enemy. Tax collectors were somebody who had sold their own people out. And he chose zealots. Zealots were the ones who wanted to transform their social situation by any means necessary. Judas Iscariot was most likely the son of, or himself, one of the Sicarii, which were dagger men who would go into a crowd and assassinate their political opponents. These are people that you would think would be passed over. They wouldn't be included. And yet, think about what Jesus said. I have come to proclaim good news to the poor, release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind. I have to think that that recovery of sight to the blind, though it was actual, it was literal, it was also figurative, because there are many of us, as there were many then, who were blind and couldn't see. They couldn't see to work and move and function in life any way than they already had. And yet Jesus came and he saw them and he sought to recover true sight to them so that they could see with God's eyes. Some of you this morning, in the situations of your life, might feel like God has passed you over. It might be the circumstances that you just find yourself in. And it might be the circumstances that you yourself crafted and created and modeled and molded into who you are. It could be those that there's those hidden secret things that only you know about. And it could be public record, literally on the public record. And the thought might be in the back of your mind, of all the people that God could possibly use, it ain't me. That's a lie. Of all the people that God could possibly use, it was Moses. Of all the people that God could possibly use, it was David. Of all the people that God could possibly use, it was Peter, James, and John. And yes, even Judas Iscariot. Of all the people that God could possibly use, it was Saul of Tarsus. Paul, in Galatians 5, he speaks of this. He speaks of the different works that we do in our lives. He speaks of the works of the flesh. He calls them obvious. He says they're fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. He says, folks, you're not going to inherit the kingdom of God if this is your life. But he doesn't say that that's it. He says that the fruit of the Spirit is this: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There's no law against such things. And can I tell you, there's no law that says that just because you've been engaged in the first list that you can't join in the second. You know, the only thing that will keep you from joining in the life of the Spirit is your refusal to do so. It's open. It's an open table. It's open for all of us. That's the point. You don't have to be passed over. It's good news, because in spite of where you are, even where you are right now, today, that's not where you have to stay. God can take even my heart and mold it and make it something new. The question is, am I willing to let him do so? Now, here's where we do have a choice. We have a choice. We can be receptive and receive that new heart, a soft, pliable heart. Or we can be like Saul. We can refuse to be changed. Let that not be us. Let us be those who will receive this good news, this good gift, because we all have a vocation in the kingdom of God. All of us. We are all created in the Imago Dei, the image of God, and our task, our job, our vocation is to reflect that image of God to the world. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your strength. And Jesus said, the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And then you will be the church. Let's pray together. O God, this morning, we recognize that there are places in our lives that might not be exactly where they need to be. We recognize that there are times that we say no to you. We turn our backs on you. Lord, today, even right now, work and move in our hearts. Chip away at the hard places that are resistant to your call. Polish away the tarnish that is inhibiting us from reflecting your image. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Amen. I'm going to invite you now, as the band comes and as we sing together, if you'd like to go and find a place and pray and kneel, either at any of the kneelers around the room or at your seat. And ask God once again to create in you that clean heart and renew that right spirit within you. Allow God a moment to remind you that you are not passed over, that you are chosen. Pray together. Oh God, we are your children. We are ones who have been set free. Lord, we ask that you would help us to live in that freedom. God, as we look around at your world, and we look at many of the things that are going on around it, it grieves our hearts. And it grieves us to see the discord that we experience in our own nation, in our own city, and sometimes even in our own church. God, we pray that you would bring about restoration and healing in our church, in our city, our state, our nation, and our world. God, help us to be attuned to those things that are bringing about destruction, so that we may live differently. God, transform us and make us into people who live into the prayer, Lord Jesus, that you taught us, your disciples, to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to continue our worship now with the giving of God's tithes and our offerings. Welcome to give as the ushers come around. You can also give online, or you can text to give or mail in your offering.
You take what is, and you make it beautiful. When love floods in, we're restored forevermore. With breath.
We are thrilled this morning to have Polly Bailey to come and share with us about Methodist Senior Services and the Sunday Fund. Polly, come on forward.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you, David. Good morning. I've been a member of Methodist Senior Services for many years, and I'm here to talk to you about one of the most caring features that Methodist Senior Services has, and that is the Sunday Fund. Senior Services maintains 12 campuses in Mississippi. And you're all familiar with Traceway in Tupelo, but there are 11 other campuses, and they are all innovators in senior care. The first greenhouse in the United States was built right here in Tupelo in 2002. And now they've been copied and duplicated for senior care throughout the entire country. I think the Sunday Fund is the most critical part of this care. Our campuses house some 1,800 residents, but there have been more than 10,000 over the years. Because of Sunday Fund, not one resident has ever been asked to move because they've outlived their financial resources. Senior Services has had a Sunday Fund for 55 years. Think about that. Not a single person has ever been asked to move because they have outlived their money. That's where the Sunday Fund comes in. This money is critical in helping folks who otherwise would have nowhere to turn. 100% of the money we give goes directly to the Sunday Fund. Listen to one resident's comments and letter that he wrote. My name is Billy, and my apartment is the one with the big blue bow on the door. I'm so thankful to the staff here for being so kind to a forgetful old man. I'm sure that the blue bow is there because I keep forgetting which apartment is mine. I have no family, and I finally used up the money from the sale of my house, and I only have a small income from Social Security. Because of the generosity of donors to the Sunday Fund, I've been able to stay in my home. Thank you. Our church has been second in the conference for 2020 in giving to the Sunday Fund. Second. We like to be first, but we need to do better in 2021, which I think we can all agree that we will do. There's no better opportunity to respect our elders and provide for their happiness than to give to the Sunday Fund. Please consider a gift. If you would like to contribute today, just mark your checks or your envelope for the Sunday Fund and put it in the baskets that went around. Next Sunday, there will be gift cards located in the pews and brochures for everyone to be able to see. Please think about Billy and hundreds of more who need help to stay in their homes. Running out of money is one of the greatest concerns of elders in today. On behalf of Billy and our deserving elders and Methodist Senior Services, thank you.
Thank you, Polly. Thank you, Polly. Now, rise. Receive the benediction. As the redeemed children of God, those who have not been passed over, go now and be the church. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Rejoice, O child of God.